And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. A warm welcome to everyone. We're pleased to have you with us. Our opening hymn is number 644, Your Words Are Spirit and Life, 644. Please stand and greet each other.
Of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. May the grace and peace of our loving God, the presence of Jesus, and the gift of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Whenever we have a mission like this, it's obviously my obligation to preach and to share the gospel. And normally, that is done by, you know, the pastor, Father Kenny, Father John, and all the priests and deacons that live and serve here. It's their obligation to do the preaching. But for these next 3 days, Father Kenny is commissioning me to do that, to preach the gospel. So he's going to give me that commissioning now.
To each of us, God has given gifts. We are all called upon to use these gifts for each other and to build up the body of Christ in our world. To some persons, God has given the particular gift of teaching and preaching. This evening, in God's name, we, the people of St. Vincent de Paul, call upon you, Father Tom, to share with us your gifts. By your sharing, may our Christian community be renewed in heart and spirit and rejoice in being called once more to live a committed Christian life. We thank you for being in our midst. We bless you in this work of yours. We offer you our willingness to be renewed in the Spirit of God and to be open to the words that you will preach to us this week. May with confidence in God's gracious power in our lives, let us begin this journey of faith.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "This is my commandment, love one another as I have loved you. There is no greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friend. You are my friends if you do what I command you. For I no longer speak of you as slaves, for a slave does not know what his master is about. Instead, I call you friends, since I have made known to you all that I heard from my Father. It was not you who chose me. It was I who chose you to go forth and to bear fruit. Live on in my love, and you will live in my love if you keep my commandments. Even as I have kept my Father's commandments and live in his love. All this I tell you, that your joy might be complete. My commandment is this: love one another as I have loved you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please stand. Creatures of habit. So for these next three afternoons, there's going to be a prayer over me before I begin to preach and to share the gospel, all right? So Deacon Dana is going to read that prayer out loud for us. Obviously, in the early church, whenever they prayed for someone, they would get together around that person and they would place their hands on the person. They believed unequivocally that the Holy Spirit would enter the person. They had no doubt about that. They believed that by the laying on of hands and praying that the Spirit of God would come into that person. I believe that, and I want that to happen for me as I share the gospel with you. So obviously there's too many of you here to get up here, but I'll kneel here. Maria's going to place her hand on me, and I'd like all of you to just gently extend a hand like this towards me and pray, as Dana prays, this prayer that the Spirit of God will come into my life.
Loving God, we thank you for the gift of your abiding love. We ask you to pour love into each one of us. Open our minds and hearts so that we can truly hear your word this night. Bless our preacher, your son, and our brother, Father Tom. May his words touch our hearts and lead us to you. We pray for this through Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit as one God forever and ever.
Amen. Now you can sit down. Thank you. Is it okay if I stand down here? I'll move around quite a bit, but this just feels easier for me. What's the matter? Oh, my water? Yeah.
He said it was.
It's right here. Just leave it alone. It's vodka. You know, this is a true story, and I can't tell it. They say whenever an Irishman says that, it's not going to be true, but this is true. So I'm a young guy in my 30s, mid-30s, I guess, and I wasn't feeling well, so I went to the doc, and he was from the parish where I lived, and they ran some tests, and then he called me, and he said, I want to talk to you. Can you come down and see me? And I'm like, do I have cancer? Just tell me. I'm not coming down there. If I got cancer, just tell me. No. Just come down. I want to talk to you, okay? So I went down. This is the truth. And this is, you know, a lot of years ago. So he says, we've ran these tests, and your liver is puffy. Your liver is quite puffy. And, you know, do you drink? Well, yeah, a little bit at, you know, a little wine at mass. He said, well, I think it's a lot of wine at mass. I said, well, okay. He said, no, it is. And he said, you got a problem here. He said, so what do you drink? And so I'm going through this, you know, and it's kind of embarrassing, you know, when you start talking about amounts and stuff, you know, and well, do you drink, you know, this much or that much? Or he said, how about this much? And I said, well, I spill that much. He says to me, what do you like to drink? I said, I like to drink gin. And he said, I take it, let's just be honest here, Padre, you drink a fair amount of gin. I said, yes, I do. I will be honest with you. I probably drink more gin than I should drink. Now, this guy was a very good physician, but this is a long time ago. He says to me, gin is probably one of the hardest alcohols on the body, one of the hardest grain alcohols on the body and on your system. He says to me, now, vodka is not aged, okay? And it would be less aggressive probably on your system. So do you think you could drink vodka? He says this to me. I said, well, I'll do my best. I'll give it a shot there, Doc. So I switched to vodka. That's a true story. You know, I mean, they wouldn't do that today, obviously, but I switched to vodka. So I drank that for, I don't know, maybe 3 years before I got carted off. But, you know, I liked it. It was good, you know. You know what? I was struck by this when you, I said the gospel of the Lord and you all plopped down for the sermon, you know. I was reminded of this story of a man who was giving his sermon, and in the middle of the sermon, he went completely blank. And the only thing he could remember was what a teacher in the seminary said, if that ever happens, if you go blank, he said, just repeat the last line that you said, and that'll get you back on track. So he remembered that much, and he repeated his last line, which was, behold, I come forth. But nothing happened. Stood there blank before this crowd. So he said a second time, behold, I come forth. Nothing happened. still blank before this big crowd. You can imagine. All right? So he tried one more time. He said, "Behold, I come forth." At which point, he fell out of the pulpit, into the first pew, knocked a lady over. Books are flying all over the place, and he's completely embarrassed, and he says, "I am so sorry. This is all my fault. I could have harmed you. I could have harmed me. I hope you're okay. This is all my fault. I hope you can see it. Forgive me. I didn't know this was going to happen. I'm very sorry. It's all my fault. I'm just really sorry, and it's all my fault." And she finally said, "Shut up." He said, "What?" She said, "It's my fault." He said, "What do you mean it's your fault?" She said, "You warned me 3 times you were coming." One of my brothers sent me this, where the priest was going to take a communion to this elderly lady, okay? And he got there, and she was on the phone, and she had this important phone call, and she couldn't get off the phone, and he was sitting there, and it was lunchtime. He wanted to eat lunch, and she was sorry she had to stay on the phone, and this went on for like 25 minutes or something like that. And finally, she got off the phone, came to see him and said, "Father, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry to make you wait like this. I know this is, you want to get home and eat lunch, and I couldn't get off the phone. I'm really sorry. I hope you forgive me. I'm sorry." He said, "Well, I need to apologize too." Because he said, "I am hungry. I want to eat my lunch, and you had this bowl of nuts there, and I ate the whole bowl. And I'm sorry. So when I come back for communion in a couple weeks, I'll bring you another bag of nuts, okay? Because I ate the whole bowl." And she said, "Father, don't do that and don't worry about it." She said, "I can't eat them anymore anyways. I just sucked the chocolate off them." You know, I need to say this maybe because, as I shared with you, this is probably the last mission. At least I have no, by now I would have 20 of these scheduled next year, okay? I don't do that anymore. This is the last one. I have none scheduled, so you can report me, whatever. But this is the last one, and it's a privilege to be here with you. It really is. And I don't take it for granted. I don't take it for granted. It's a very powerful position to be in when there's one microphone and I have it, okay? I understand that, and I don't want to abuse the microphone, but I see this as a great privilege in my life and as a redemptorist, especially this probably being the last one I'm going to do. And so it brings back a lot of emotion for me and memories, you can imagine. And especially with the laughter, you know? I was in another city up north. This was a year or two ago. And so this lady who was at the mission every night, she got all upset. And she wrote me a letter, and she sent a letter to the bishop there, the archbishop there, and it was like, "I thought his talks were spot on, inspirational, inspiring in every way, and deeply moving for me. But there simply was too much laughing in church." I don't. And I, okay. You know, I mean, this is obviously whatever. You know, I'm not going to get into that kind of thing. People think church is supposed to be this and supposed to be that, and we can't do this and we better do that. And there's no point in getting into arguing about any of that stuff. There really isn't. Okay? But I'm going to tell you a couple of things. So when I was in Chicago working at a treatment center there, all right, residential, and we had outpatient, we had all kinds of stuff, all right? Now, when these people would be released, if they had enough recovery capital so we could get them situated somewhere in their living circumstances, we had all these protocols that we had to go through, okay? Now, in the middle of those protocols was this. Does this person who's leaving treatment, man or woman, do they have the capacity to really laugh? Do they have a sense of humor? This had nothing to do with introvert, extrovert, and all this other stuff. Can they genuinely laugh with and at themselves and with others. It was part of the development that they have this sense of humor, this capacity to laugh. What do we do without that, you know? Already, Father John, your good buddy here, I've been laughing like mad with this guy, you know? He's not a real bright guy, but he's trying, you know? No, but anyways, this ability to laugh and to laugh at ourselves, how essential it is. You see, you don't know me. I don't know you, all right? But what can the laughter do? It will open us up. It will open you and me up so that we can receive each other and you can receive what I might share with you. And if you don't like some of the stuff I say, forget about it. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Just receive whatever God is going to bring to you. Don't get in the way of yourself. Like, no, I don't like that, and I don't know about that. Well, maybe that ain't, you know. Well, I don't know. When I used to be a Catholic, What's the point of all that? It doesn't matter. I want to do everything I can to share my life with you and to be respectful of you. All of you. All of you, you see. But the laughter is essential. It's essential. Okay, so years ago, there was this company, I don't know where they were from. I think it was St. Louis, actually. I was living in Chicago, and they said, well, we want to tape your talks, a series of your talks. And they put them on these, what do you call, disc or something? Now you've got YouTube and all this other stuff. We're going to tape them, and we'll tell you what. We'll give the Redemptor 70%, all right? We'll keep 30. And I said, if you want to do that, that's fine. I don't want anything to do with it. Nothing. I'm not going to be taking these things around with me. And it felt weird to me to come to churches like this and say, you want to buy my tapes? You know? I mean, and I listened to talks, but I didn't want to get into it. I just didn't want to do it. I said, you guys want to do it? Fine. But don't ask me for anything. I'm going to trust you that you're going to do this properly. I don't want anything to do with it. Okay, and they did. All right, now they're no longer in print or whatever, so you don't have to ask about that. But anyways, one of these tapes, a series of these tapes, got in the hands of this woman who was a writer in a lot of syndicated columnist stuff, and she listened to my tapes. And she really liked them and blah, blah, blah. And so we exchanged a couple letters, and then I was going to be meeting with her. She lived in Phoenix at the time. And she was dealing with kidney issues, which I understand. I only have one kidney. And so we talked about that, and I was looking forward to meeting her. She had got sick, and she passed away, and I didn't get to meet her. But her name was Irma Bombeck, okay? So you remember Irma. Tremendous writer, tremendous writer. Irma sends this. In church the other day, on Sunday, I was intent on a small boy who was turning around smiling at everyone. He wasn't gurgling, spitting, humming, and kicking, or tearing the hymnals, or rummaging through his mother's handbag. He was just smiling, and then he started laughing. And he was really laughing. He was just laughing. Finally, his mother jerked him about, and in a stage whisper that could have been heard in a little theater off Broadway, said, "Stop that laughing, you're in church." And then with that, she gave him a belt upside his head, and the tears rolled down his cheeks. Then she added, "That's better." And then the old biddy returned to her prayers. Suddenly, Irma said, "I was angry. It occurred to me the entire world is in tears, and then if you're not, you'd better get with it. I wanted to grab this boy with the tear-stained face close to me and tell him about my God, the happy God, the smiling God, the God who had to have a sense of humor to have created the likes of us. My God, whom I implore every day, God, if you cannot make me thin, please, God, make my friends fat." "By tradition," she said, "one wears faith with the solemnity of a mourner, the gravity of a mask of tragedy, or the dedication of a rotary badge." What a fool, I thought. Here was this woman sitting next to one of the only lights left in our civilization, one of our only hopes, our only miracles. are only promise of infinity. And if this small boy couldn't laugh in church, then where was there left to go? Amen to that?
Amen.
You betcha. Amen to that. Thank you, Irma. God be good to you. As I'm ending my career here, I was thinking of this. I'm going through notes and stuff, and I said, I used to collect these bloopers that were in church bulletins, actual bloopers, you know. I collected them. I'll share some with you. For example, this afternoon there will be a meeting in the south and north ends of the church. Children will be baptized at both ends. This being Easter Sunday, we will ask Mrs. Brown to come forward and lay an egg on the altar. A bean supper will be held on Saturday evening in the church basement. Music will follow. Here's one for the choir or whatever. Tonight's sermon, What is Hell? Come early and listen to our choir practice. Potluck supper, prayer and medication to follow. Hey, don't let worry kill you off. Let the church help. Now, I actually saw this in Michigan, I think it was Harper Woods or something like that, in Michigan, outside Detroit. You know, the Protestants will put up a marquee with the titles of the sermons. I actually saw this, driving by saw this, and nearly wrecked my car. It said, morning sermon text, Jesus walks on the water. Evening sermon text, searching for Jesus. Okay, one more here. One of my nephews sent me this. I have trouble getting through these without laughing, but okay, so a young couple got married, but they didn't have much time for a honeymoon since both of them were in sales work. A couple of weeks after the wedding, the wife needed to fly to New York and the husband to Miami for their sales work. They decided that they would spend the weekend in Miami as she could fly there after their meetings in New York. Okay? Are you with me? All right. So the husband arrives in Miami on Thursday and he decides to send his new bride an email, but he lost her email address. So going by memory, he sends her an email anyway, and unfortunately he missed one letter in her email address. The email message went instead to a minister's wife whose husband had just died the day before. Okay, so that morning the minister's family was gathered at his home and the minister's wife decided to check her email for any condolences that might have been sent. All right, suddenly the family heard this loud thump from the computer room and rushed in to find the minister's wife passed out on the floor. Then they looked on the computer screen and the message on the screen said, "Sweetheart, just got checked in." Anxiously awaiting your arrival tomorrow. By the way, it sure is hot down here. Okay. Well, you know what? Let's just take a moment to either fist bump, hug, shake hands, whatever. Stand up and welcome everybody. Great to be with you. Great to be with you. Rev?
I've seen you before.
Good to see you. Bless you. Many blessings. God bless you. God bless. Good to be with you. Good to be with you. God bless you. Bless you. God bless all of you. Good to be with you. All right. Okay, have a seat. Oh, yeah. Wow. Okay. I'll just move back a little bit, but I'll move around. So, how to get the right thing here. Okay, good. Just got to go over here. Okay. So, I am in Baton Rouge last fall, and I wanted to share this with them. It's written by a third grader. You'll enjoy this because they asked these third graders to describe what a grandparent is. All right? Since I've been here, many of you come up to me telling me about your grandkids already, being a grandparent. So they asked third graders to write about what's a grandparent like, you know? So I'm reading this in Baton Rouge last fall, and I get ready to read it, and I'm standing there in a big crowd like this, and I asked a rhetorical question, which was, how old is a third grader, you know? I didn't want an answer. I think that's what a rhetorical question is, okay? I didn't want an answer. But I say, I don't know, how old is a third grader? Vince, who's sitting right there, 88-year-old man, right from the bayou, old Vince, he's sitting there and he's got his glasses like this, and he says loudly, I said, so I don't know how old a third grader is. And he goes, Father, I was 16. he just yells this out. Okay. All right, here you go. Here's what the third grader wrote. She writes, a grandmother is a lady who had no children of her own. A grandfather is a man grandmother. He goes for walks with the boys and they talk about fishing and stuff like that. Now, grandmothers don't have to do anything except be there. They are so old, they shouldn't play hard or run when they take us for walks. They should slow down when they pass pretty leaves and caterpillars. They should never say hurry up. Grandmothers are usually fat. But not too fat to tie your shoes. They wear glasses and funny underwear. And they can even take their teeth and gums off. Grandmothers don't have to be smart. Only smart enough to answer questions like, why isn't God married and why do dogs chase cats? Everybody should have a grandmother, especially if you don't have a TV. Now why? This little 8-year-old kid says, why? Because they're the only ones among the grown-ups who seem to have time. They're the only ones among the grown-ups who seem to have time. I thank you for your time, that you would give it to each other and to me as well. As my time in this work is winding down, it's still a gift that you would give to me your time. So I thank you for that. I mean that sincerely. Okay? Thank you for your time. You know, I've been thinking about this the last year as you write talks and go through things. Is there more to life than being happy? Is there more to life than being happy? And you know, what's the difference between being happy and having a meaningful life? What's the difference, you know? I noticed that many of the psychologists in the field that I work in will define happiness as comfort and ease, you know, feeling good in the moment. There's the psychologist Seligman who says that meaning comes from belonging and serving, and that's where happiness is. So how do you and I live more meaningfully? How do we do that? Whether we're 15 or 90, it doesn't matter. How do I live a more meaningful life is the question, all right? There was a psychologist, Emily Smith. She spent several years interviewing and studying people. For 5 or 7 years she did this, studying thousands of people to find out, what does a meaningful life look like? What's it look like? If someone was to say to you, what's a meaningful life look like? How would you describe it, you know? So what she did was, when she did this study, she produced 4 pillars, all right, that she thought were part of what it meant to have a meaningful life. 4 pillars. Her first pillar was this: belonging. These people that she studied had a sense of belonging, all right, where you are valued for who you are intrinsically. And there's a recognition of the other. What happens when you're valued for who you are and there's a recognition of the other? What does that do? It increases value for both. Okay? That's the deepest sense of belonging. All right? Now, here's what we know. We do know this, that if you chase happiness, you will be very unhappy. All right? I know that because I did that for years. And the National Institute of Health, of which I read regularly their peer-reviewed articles, it states something that right now, today, April, what is it, 15th? Yes. Oh, taxes. Oh, for you. I don't pay taxes. You know? I don't have personal income, so I don't have to pay taxes. So that's one less thing I have to complain about. All right? But anyways, April 15th, all right? Here's what they said. Right now, we know this, that in 37 years, we are at the highest rate of suicide in our country right now, in 37 years, all right? So while you think about this, we have been through a very painful time in our lives, many of us. We still reference, since I came here, I have heard this referenced at least 5 or 6 times, the pandemic. It'll be a reference point for us for the rest of our lives. The first time I heard about it here was when this family center was built. Oh, it was built right before the pandemic, they said to me. The pandemic is going to be a point of reference for us forever. And maybe rightfully so, you know, just the pain and the torture of it for everybody, apart from political sentiment and that other stuff. It was difficult for all of us, okay? But then I think about my life as I'm sitting over there in this room where I'm sitting, and I'm thinking, but my life is better than it's probably ever been in some ways, in every conceivable standard. My life is better, you know? And yet more people feel depressed and hopeless and alone. There is an emptiness gnawing away at people, and you don't have to be clinically depressed to see this. I see it frequently, you know? And I don't care how old you are. All of us get to this place in our lives where we will say eventually, is this all there is? Is this it? Is this all there is? You know, like the song, is that all there is? Then let's keep dancing, you know? Now, according to the researchers, what predicts this despair? What predicts this lack of hope? What is it? What it predicts this lack of happiness in people's lives, all right? What is it? What is it? Here's what it is. It's a lack of meaning. A lack of meaning. So, belonging was her first pillar. What was the second one? Purpose. Purpose is not about finding the job that makes you happy. What is purpose about? It's less about what you want and much more about what you give. I was incredibly fortunate in my life to have the parents that I had. They were fabulous human beings, okay? They didn't go to school. They didn't learn about parenting, you know, and all this other stuff. They didn't have the skills that are available today. They had none of it. But by God, they did a pretty good job, you know. And I could sit around and blame them for stuff all day long, you know, because parents can do stupid things. I get that. But my mother and father, I was fortunate to have them and who they were and how they lived, you know. And this, you know, I'll tell you, here's another thing that we need in our society today. And I wrote an article on this not too long ago for a publication in St. Louis. We need a statute of limitation on the blaming of parents. Okay? We do. When I was in treatment for alcohol and drug addiction, all I was doing was blaming, blaming, blaming. Finally, the therapist said to me, the psychiatrist, "Now what? Now what? Okay, you've got that off your chest. Now what?" Well, I don't know. I didn't want to stop blaming. All right? But I think a purpose and parents who are doing this all the time, and you as grandparents who are doing it all the time, or as great-grandparents still involved with their children and helping them, and they're struggling with divorce or drug addiction, and they need help financially and spiritually and emotionally, and you feel that you don't know what to do, but you're in the struggle of this, you know? But purpose, it gives us the why of what drives us forward. So we have what? She said, a meaningful life. We have belonging and purpose. There were four things. What was the third thing? Transcendence. She said, all these people I studied, they had some experience of the transcendent or of God. You and I would not be here today if we didn't have this experience of God. That's why we're sitting here right now. And they found it in family, in church, in art, in the culture, in reading, in writing, in the environment, this experience of God. And when you have this experience of the transcendent, what happens? It changes people. It always does. That experience I had with Rebecca on the plane was transcendent. It changed her and it changed me. All right? So we have belonging, purpose, and transcendence. What's the last thing she noticed about people that had a meaningful life? Storytelling. They told stories all the time. All right? You create a narrative about yourself and about your life, which helps you to become you and understand who you are. People living lives of belonging, of purpose, and of transcendence, she told us, they tell a lot of stories. But she said, I noticed this. They tell a lot of redemptive stories where the bad is redeemed by the good. She said, I see that all the time. They've had difficult lives. And they're retired and stuff, and they think they should just kind of be okay now, but they're still living with stuff that they have to live with and try to help. But she said they tell stories that the good is somehow going to outweigh the bad. They tell stories of growing up with redemption and growth and all the pain. They do. Belonging, purpose, transcendence, and storytelling. That's what a meaningful life looks like. Okay, so belonging, purpose, transcendence, and storytelling. I grew up in an Irish Catholic family, all right? I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri, where God is the most happy, okay? Where did I grow up, actually, in that city? I grew up around a table. It was a table like this. It was a long, square table with a Formica tabletop with a metal rim around it, okay? You ever seen one of them? I grew up around one of those tables, all right? And every Friday and Saturday night, the drinking aunts and uncles would show up at the house, and they'd sit around that table, and they would drink their whiskey, and they would drink probably a lot of beer, whiskey, whatever, and then they'd sit there, and they would tell stories, and they'd tell them over and over again. They did it every Friday and Saturday night around that table, all right? And that's really where I got my education and my learning, was around that table, all right? And so they did it every Friday and Saturday night, you know. They would tell these stories as if they had never told them before. They told them the week before, okay? Now, you think that's funny? They would laugh like they never heard them before. They heard them the week before. This went on and on and on in my life. It did. That's what they did. They told stories around the table. Then they would eventually get up and they'd be going home, cleaning up, you know, putting the booze away or whatever. And, you know, they smoked their Camel cigarettes. I remember one of my uncles, he had, you know, he'd have the Camel cigarettes in his sleeve up here, you know, with the Zippo lighter, you know. And man, I remember I thought that was the coolest thing. He'd light that cigarette, take a big drag on it, and he'd blow out smoke for like 5 minutes, you know. It'd be coming out. I thought that was so cool, you know. They'd all leave, you know, and then Ma and Pa would be down there in the kitchen. And Pa, I'd be sitting at the table like this, me and Timmy, my twin. I'm like in third grade or whatever. And Pa would tell us, we got to go to bed. Go, you guys, go, go. Well, we'd go up to the landing. I would just stay at the landing, and I'd just sit there. And I would listen. I wanted to hear this, you know. And we'd just be sitting there. And then they'd finally all leave, and Pa and Ma would leave the kitchen after they got most of it cleaned up. She'd stay down there, and she'd say, Pa, go on. You go on up. All right? Well, I'd hear their feet leave the linoleum floor of the kitchen, and they'd land on this hardwood floor in the hallway, you know. And I knew they were down there because my Pa's feet would hit the register. Remember those registers? Yeah. So I'd look down there, and there they'd be. And now, when we were growing up, we didn't really like our mom. She was strict. Mother was strict. I mean, she really was. I remember Jimmy Gavin in the alley one day, we're playing, and old lady Gavin got mad at her son, and she said, "You wait till your father gets home." My twin brother Timmy said, "Oh, God, we pray for Dad to come home." You know? I mean, Mother was strict. She was very strict. She was not into fun. She was not into fun. That was not part of her life at that time, raising 8 children. She was strict and about business, okay? I remember going to kindergarten. She walked Timmy and I over to that kindergarten right outside the door. She went over to catch the streetcar, 1958 or whatever, to go down to work at the post office credit union, scrubbing floors, you know, on her hands and knees. And she was a brilliant woman. And that's what she did. And I remember Timmy and I running after her. We wouldn't go into the building. She came back and stayed there, you know. And then she went off to catch the streetcar. She got away and we went after her again. I can still see myself doing that. She came, brought us back to the building. Years later, I said, "Ma, I remember that. Is that true?" She said, "Yes." I said, "Well, what did you do?" She said, "Well, I just stayed in the room then till you and Timmy got busy. And then I left to go to work. Scrubbing floors and all this kind of stuff." The guy that ran the credit union got to know her, same family in Ireland, same places. And so he said, "Why don't you come in and work on the credit union one day a week, you know?" And she said, no, thank you. I'm doing this to help my husband raise our kids." She was very matter of fact, all right? He kept pursuing her, and I guess it was, so she went into work on the credit union, and I think 29 years later, it had about 40,000 members, and she retired as the CEO, okay? And never finished high school. Brilliant woman. But no, I mean, not fun, at least at that time. She was not fun. She was all about business and serious, you know. And so here we are looking at them down there at the bottom of the step, Timmy and I. And Pa's got his arms around her like this, and he's resting his chin on the top of her head. And he couldn't hold her any closer. Just hold her there. We're like third grade. Timmy, now he's a retired psychiatrist, my twin, right? We're looking at this, and he goes, "That's disgusting." He said, and then Timmy says to me, "And you know what else? I mean, we were very protective of Pa, you know." He said, "Pa, Tommy, he sleeps with her." Third grade. He said, "What do you think?" I said, "Just shut up, shut up." Yeah. Then we'd run up the stairs, you know, after he let her go. When I got ordained a priest, Pa said to me, "If I look over at those stairs, Tommy, I can still hear your footsteps running up those stairs." You know, it's a memory of my life. You know, I really did get my education around that table. You know, the good and the bad, the indifferent and all of it, it was right there. And there was always somebody there. You know, in the Irish background, there's this need to suffer, you know. And my grandmother Rose from Ireland, she was a great lady. True story. Grandma Rose, listen to this. I'm going to my first baseball game in Kansas City. They're playing the Yankees. We hated the Yankees, okay? Because we had been the Yankees farm team. We hated them. I'm going to my first baseball game. All right? Late 50s. I can't believe it. Sister Mary Teresa let me keep my glove in the classroom. And I'm throwing the ball in it. I'm left-handed. I'm throwing in it all day. I can't. I'm so I'm juiced about this, you know? Mantle, Maris, Tony Kubek, Elston Howard, Hank Bauer. You remember these names? I'm going to this game. I'm juiced about this. And the Royals, you know, we had Norm Seaburn, Joe Pignatano, different players like that, Wayne Causey. I am juiced. Grandma comes out. I'm on the porch there waiting for Pa to come up the street, you know, take his uniform off. We're going to the game. Grandma Rose, Tommy, what are you doing? I'm waiting for Pa. We're going to the ball game. Oh, you're so happy. I said, I am, Grandma. So happy. What, come in and eat something. I can't eat, Grandma. I'm too excited. Oh, you're so happy. I said, I am. I'm really happy, Grandma. She said, don't worry. Don't worry. No matter how happy you are, there'll be enough sadness to get you through it. But there's an enormous amount of truth to that today. As I age, as I get older, you can only understand it as you get older that there's a mix, you know? There's a genuine mix of sadness and joy that we all carry. We have the one common denominator of loss in our lives. I see it in your faces when I talk to you and you come up to me and you speak so kindly to me. And I just look at you and I can see, you know, the loss that many of you have suffered. You know, I see it. It's what we have most in common. And yet it's what we talk about the least, you know? I don't know why that is, you know, but so here's growing up there, you know? And where meaning in my life started, where a sense of belonging started around that table, you know? It was right there, you know? And somebody said to me at a workshop, I shared that in St. Louis a couple weeks ago, just that image of the table and stuff. And this woman came up to me and said, do you have a minute? And I said, yeah. She said, well, I didn't grow up that way, Father. She said, I come from a dysfunctional family, Father. I thought, oh, God. I wanted to say, you know, just shut up. I mean, I'd never say that, you know, I'm not going to say that. But she's saying it to me like she's the only person that comes from dysfunction. Are you kidding me? My God, you shake my family tree, it's just dysfunction, you know? Except for Ma and Pa. They were not drinkers, they didn't like it. And, you know, but I mean, we got all kinds of dysfunction in our lives. Every one of us comes from it, you know, from the written rules to the unwritten ones. The unwritten ones, Uncle Frank, home from the service, all right? I'm third grade, coming down the stairs. Uncle Frank laid out at the bottom of the stairs, completely drunk, laying there, 6 o'clock in the morning. And I said to my brother Pat, hey, what, Uncle Frank, what are you talking about? I said, hey. He said, come here, just get in here. You got to eat breakfast. I just step over Uncle Frank and go on in and eat my breakfast, you know? Right. A couple years go by, my cousin Brian is staying with us now. All right, he's got all kinds of family problems. So I'm there in the kitchen. Brian comes down. Uncle Eddie laid out right there, just bombed out of his mind, laying there sound asleep, you know? Uncle Eddie or Brian goes, Tommy, hey, what about, what? I said, what? He said, Uncle Eddie, what? I said, get in here, you got to eat breakfast. You know, we got to go. That's how the deal works. You just pass it on. It's not willful or intentional. You pass on the dysfunction. It's how it works. You all have it in your life, and I have it in mine, you know, as we like search for meaning in our life. Here I am, a young priest, getting ordained, you know. And I got all this zeal and fervor, and I'm 26. And when I was 26, I was a good-looking guy. You know, they called me Father What a Waste. You know, they did. So now, you know, what am I going to do, you know? I'm 26 years old. I just get out of the seminary. What's happening? I'm starting to prepare these couples for marriage. I've been in the seminary for the last 12 years with guys, you know, wonderful guys, but now I'm out, you know? And I'm meeting all these people. And then I'm preparing these couples that are my age and they're getting married. And I'm like, oh my gosh, look at this. And she's beautiful. And they're getting married. What was I thinking? What was I thinking? You know, and then I'm thinking this stuff too, like, you know, they're so nice, and I see them even in church, and they're a beautiful couple, they're getting married, and they're probably having sex every night, you know. What about me? You know? I mean, what the heck? And then, you know, you got an Irish Catholic family that I grow up in, 8 of us kids, you know, so you got to get a priest or a nun out of that, you know. In the late 50s, and you know, that's got to be, so here I am, you know, I become a priest, and I'm in the sacristy. I've been a priest 4 days. I'm going to say my first mass, okay? My twin, Timmy, comes in, right? I'm going to say my first mass. Tommy, I need to talk to you. What is it? He said, I want to thank you for taking one for the team. Yeah, so you know what I mean? What do you do? I want no sympathy or anything like that. Believe me, I want nothing like that. My life is sacred to me like yours, you know? I didn't believe that for a long time, but it is. I don't want any sympathy about anything like that, you know? But it's just that, you know, if you just think about it naturally, it's got to be a struggle, right? We're not stupid, you know? You got a 26-year-old guy who's single, a priest, running around trying to be nice to people, you know? As my sister said, that's attractive, you know? Well, it makes sense, right? So I'm like, well, what do I do? You know, I'm a single guy, I'm celibate now, you know, and I'm a priest, and oh, man, I can't believe this. So what do you do? Well, you know, I know, like, at night when my work is done, what I got to do. So they'd meet at a bar, so I'd go down there and I'd get drinking with people and stuff. Well, that's what I did. I just drank, you know, because I didn't know how to deal with the loneliness, you know. And how do I deal with it? Well, I'll just numb myself. I'll drink, you know. And you know, loneliness. Hey, let me tell you something about loneliness. You don't have to look for it. It will find you. Oh, it will find you. Married, single, it doesn't matter. Loneliness will find you. It's not far away. It isn't. Believe me, it's not. But I was so young, I didn't know how to deal with it. And how do you be happy, right? And I'm thinking you just got to be juiced and just ecstatic and always happy. And that's what I thought, you know. And I had all these extremes, like these married couples are, you know, probably, like I said, they're loving each other, having sex every night, and they're having great lives, and look at me, blah, blah, blah. And then you start meeting them some years later, and you find out that ain't happening, you know. And they tell you, hey, Father Tom, stay where you are there, buddy. Yeah. Father Tom, stay where you are, pal. You're going to be okay. No, but I mean, you know, so, but anyways, you got to be just happy all the time or ecstatic all the time. Or what am I going to do or how do I deal with? So that I drank, you know, and I drank a lot and then used drugs and just trying to, you know, to numb the hard feelings. These hard feelings that you don't like. Let me tell you something about numbing. Whether it's prescription drugs, which a lot of people over 60 have addiction to, and we're over-prescribed, by the way, you should know that, down here, all right? But I'll tell you what, these hard feelings that you don't like, you can't just selectively numb, all right? I thought I can just numb those feelings and go to bed, you know, but you can't. If you numb that stuff, you numb the joy, you numb the gratitude, you numb the graciousness, you numb the kindness, you numb it all. You can't selectively numb and do drugs. You just can't, all right? So, you know, they came and they talked to me about, you know, hey, you got to be careful with your drinking and stuff. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. All right, so, you know, then it just finally, it got so bad. I don't have a lot of memories of this, but I was laying in my room. I was on the floor in my bedroom in my clothes. I think I'd been there a couple of days. And I was just laying there in my own urine, just laying there, okay? So I remember they came to get me, and I remember this. At least I thought I remembered it. One of the priests was holding me like this in the crook of his arm. And I remember he said, "Tommy, you don't need to be punished. You need help. You need help. That's all. You don't need to be punished." I never forgot that. I went to treatment, you know, for several months. And I got out. I saw him 2 years later. And I said, "Did you say that to me? That I didn't need to be punished, I just needed help?" "Yeah, that's exactly what I said to you. Those are my words for you, you know?" That was a gift, because you think you need to be punished, you know? I can't be forgiven. Even when I know I can go to church or go to confession or whatever, and I somehow get this forgiveness. Here's the most difficult thing with forgiveness. A lot of people get forgiven and still don't believe they are. That's a fact. That is a fact, so help me God. I deal with it all the time in recovery work. When they can tell you face to your face, "I know I've been forgiven," but they don't believe it. They can't trust it somehow. That's the pain of addiction, one of the deepest pains of it. So, you know, so I'm hearing, and you live with all this shame, you know, of my behavior. And then, you know, here's one for you, an Irish guy taking one for the team. Okay, so I get home. You know, my first thought is, I'm going to see Ma and Pa. I'm so ashamed that this happened. And, you know, I'm the priest in the family. You know, the only thing I ever wanted was them to be proud of me. And I've turned into this mess, you know. And, oh, God, you know. So I get home. I'm standing there on the porch. My father was a very quiet man. Very quiet, just the opposite of my mother. My father never talked about the faith. My mother never shut up about it, okay? That was the dynamic. I'm standing there on the porch, I can remember like this, you know? And I had my eyes kind of down, looking down. There's Pa right there. He says, "Tommy, lift your head up. Put your head up." So I put my head up. He looked right at me, he said, "I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you." You have no idea what that meant. Those were what that meant to me, that he would say that to me. It skyrocketed me into recovery and into it to this day. That was 30 years ago. I'm telling you about it right now with tears in my eyes. It skyrocketed me, the power of a mother or father and their words to a son or a daughter. You see, you know that well. The shame thing and guilt, you know, it can get a hold of you. You know, and there's a huge difference between these things, right? I'll tell you, you know, guilt, what is guilt? Guilt says, "I made a mistake." What is your first name?
Sue.
Sue, it's like if I said something and I hurt Sue, I would say, guilt says, "Hey, you need to apologize to Sue." So I would say, "Sue, I'm sorry. I made a mistake, I was wrong." That's what guilt does, okay? What does shame do? Guilt says, "I made a mistake." Shame says, "I am a mistake." Oh, you can't recover from that. You stay in it. You're going to use and abuse. You just are. You know, I know you are. I know how it goes. You know, so we search in booze or drugs for the meaning of our lives. You know, and I see this with people a lot now. The pornography. You know, it hooks men, young men, older men. It just hooks them and preoccupies them. And they go through the shame of it all by dealing with it, and then "I'm not going to deal with it." And then they're called back to it, and they can't get out of it, and they feel trapped. You know, all of that. It's painful. And a lot of it is from a lack of meaning. And it was Carl Jung who said to Bill Wilson, this stays in my head. He said, "I'm convinced at this point that the addiction is a spiritual problem." He said that the addiction is ultimately, I think, a spiritual problem. Carl Jung said that, you see. And so we struggle with, like, you know, booze, alcohol, the internet porn. And it skews these young men's lives as well as women. But then they can't perform sexually with their spouses and the difficulty of it and all the trappings that go with it and all the shame. It's painful. You see it when they come and talk to me, the pain in their eyes, you know? And the first step is to talk, to just simply talk to someone, you know? Because what's the fear? That you're alone. You're not alone. You're not alone. You are not. Why is it when we lose a loved one, we think we're alone? This goes on every day with millions of people who lose their spouse, their son, their daughter, to tragedy, to death, whatever it is. We share that in common, but we act like we're alone. We're not alone. You are not alone. I am not alone. I'm not. I'm so privileged that I can share my life with you right now in this moment. I'm not alone. No, I'm not. It's something that is so important to get through our mind. So we search for meaning in booze, in food, you know, in sex, in work. Now, maybe not now for many of you who are retired. I had a guy tell me this a couple weeks ago. He said, I got 6 kids, Padre. And he said, I work hard, and my wife and I were doing the best we can. But he said, I figured something out. I'm staying at work longer now than I really need to, because if I go home, I got to be a husband and a daddy. And that's difficult to do. And he said, who's going to object to work, right? That's the American ethic. I got to work, you know? That's a great insight on his part, you know? And then we search in relationships. I see this all the time, you know? Marrying couples, you know? I've prepared so many couples in my life. And then marrying couples. I've never done this, but I want to do it someday. You know, she's back there, going to come down the aisle, and the guys are up here. I want to leave the altar, and I want to go like this. I want to run down here. I want to get her about right here. And I want to say, you got a minute? I want to tell you something right now. You don't want to do this. You don't want to do this. I mean, look at Goofy up there, you know? You don't want to do that. And she's coming down the aisle, and he's up there, you know? And I've never been married in my life, and I can tell you something right now. I know more about this than they do. I know that I do. I know that I do, you know? And they're, you know, we think, you know what? I see this. If I just find that one person who's going to make me happy, that one person who's going to fulfill me and make me happy, that's what I need to find, you see? And then you start looking for that person. And then you start thinking that somehow that person was created just for you to find them so that they could make you happy. Oh, really? How's that working out? You know? That there's just somebody out there waiting to make you happy. Try that one out for a while. You know, that's what kept me drinking. You know? That one person's out there going to make me happy. Oh, you bet. So we search in relationships, food, booze, whatever it is, for what was meant from the very beginning. You know, from the very beginning. When you read the scriptures right here in the Bible, B-I-B-L-E, B-I-B-L-E, Bible, B-I-B-L-E, what does that mean? Basic information before leaving Earth. You can say that with me now. Basic information before leaving Earth. Say it again. Basic information before leaving Earth. Say it again. Basic information before leaving Earth. If you read basic information before leaving Earth in the very first book of the Bible, in the very first chapter of the Bible, it says, male and female, he created them in his own image and his own likeness. That is where we belong. That's the table. That's the origin, that you and I are sacred, made in the image and likeness of God. That is the foundation of your life and mine, okay? That's where we need to be and where we need to stay, that we're made in the image and likeness of God, and that is sacred, absolutely sacred. Now, I got to see here. Woo! Okay. All right, it's a little, a little more vodka. Okay, we'll go just a few more minutes. I didn't realize it goes so fast. Well, for me, it goes fast. And it's my last one, so I don't care. You don't like it, too bad. So anyways, okay, here. So in working, I find this with people that I've worked with in addiction and stuff. And it comes out of some Catholic stuff and some Christian stuff. They'll get into this right away. Well, you know, I'm not worthy, Father. I'm not worthy. I'm so unworthy, Father. That drives me nuts. That's an ego thing that people like to get into. It's a control thing. You know, we think it's pious religion. You know, that da-da-da-da-da. You know, I'm just not worthy, you know. That drives me crazy. So I'm giving a nun's retreat in Minnesota. 80 sisters and me, okay? I've given a lot of these retreats with sisters, and I enjoy it immensely, and I enjoyed them even more so for who they are and how they live their lives. But I've been at this retreat now for 7 days. It's 10 days, and I don't know whether they like it or not, and it's going to drive me crazy at some point because it's 10 days, and I'm getting tired. And so I'm in the sacristy waiting to go out to talk, to give my next talk in the morning. And I'm waiting because this one sister got a hold of me and said, Father, you came out early to start the talk. Don't do that. We wait till the clock chimes. Then you can come out and give your conference. But don't come out, Father, from the sacristy until the clock chimes. Then you can come out, Father. But just stay in there till the clock chimes. I said, are you happy? She says, of course I'm happy. I said, well, you better tell your face. I said, it ain't getting the message. So anyways, I'm there waiting for that stupid clock to chime. And I'm exhausted. This is the seventh day. And I'm thinking, oh my God, three more days. And I'm thinking to myself, well, maybe I could just smoke some weed. That ain't all that bad. And I'm thinking, I wonder if they locked that wine up. So finally, this little old nun slowly wins her way into the sacristy before the clock chimes, and she says to me, Father Tom, do you have a moment? Yes. What is it, sister? Father Tom, I've been making these retreats now. This is my 60th one. I've made a 10-day retreat every year for 60 years. I want to tell you something right now. This is the best retreat of my life. I can't tell you. It's the best. And I only have you to thank for it. It's the absolute best, Father Tom. I need to say that to you. Really? Really? Well, thank you. Thank you so much. And then she left and went out. Well, I thought, God, wow, really? I start doing the math. She's made 60 of these, 60 10-day retreats. It was 4 talks a day. So one retreat is 40 talks. She's made 60 of them. That's 2,400 talks, right? Mine's the best. Yeah. So when that clock chimed, I walked out there, you know. I said, you know what? I'll give them 10 more days. I got down there and I made the sign of the cross and I got ready to give my opening conference, and that same sister that had spoken to me was sitting right there, and she said very loudly right there to the sister next to her, she said, sister, have I had my breakfast yet? But what I need to say to you and share with you is simply this, that you are totally loved in this moment. It has nothing to do with worthiness or unworthy. It doesn't. I'm not worthy of God's love. I'm not unworthy of God's love. I'm loved. That's it. I don't need to play games with that stuff. I don't. And then the same nun in that retreat sitting back there goes to me, can I ask you a question, Father? I could see it on her face, you know. I said, yeah, what is it, sister? She said, well, you keep saying it's not about worthy. Then why is it at Mass that we say, Lord, I am not worthy? Why do we say that, Father? And I walked back and I thought, you know what? I could smack her, you know. I ought to just go back there and I wanted to say, this is for all the kids you smacked, you know? But, hey, I got a grace. I went back to her and I said, sister, before I answer your question, can I ask you one? She said, oh, go ahead, Father, go right ahead. I said, why is it at Mass, sister? We say, Lord, we thank you for counting us
worthy.
She said, oh, Father, never mind. But that's all that I want to say to you is that you are totally and completely loved in this moment. And I am so privileged to announce it. In the early church, there were two things critical to the development of the early church. I'll tell you what they are, and I'll do this quickly. All right? In the development of the early church, they were kerygma and didache. Very essential to the development of our early church, our ancestors. All right? So, what was kerygma? It was the announcement of God, the proclamation of God. That was kerygma, the announcing. What was didache? Well, it was how are we going to live together? How are we going to do this, you know? It was sort of collecting all the stuff that's going to form us into a community. How do we form in this new way, as it was called in the Greek or in the Aramaic? It was the new way. So that was kind of the didache. How do we put this together to be a community? So you got the didache, you got the kerygma. So they go to C.H. Dodd, a Scottish scholar, probably one of the best. And they say to Dodd, what brought those Jewish people to faith? Was it the kerygma or the didache? He looked at him and said, absolutely, it was the didache. It was the announcement of God. When somebody simply announced God, that brought people to faith. That brought people to faith. So I'm preaching at a black parish in Cleveland, all right? And as Viola meets me before we start the service, and she says to me, you preaching tonight, Father Tom? I said, yes, I am, Viola. She said, don't be giving me no guilt. She said, I got more guilt with me than you could ever inspire. Then she put her hand on her hip and she said, give me some kerygma, baby. She did. And as she's backing down the aisle, she says to me loudly, Father Tom, just announce God. Just announce God, Father Tom. Just announce God. Please announce God, Father Tom. And then get out of the way, because God is always on time. God is always on time. Just announce God to me, Father Tom, that you are totally loved in this moment, never to change. Never to change. And in this moment right now, we cannot be any closer to God than we are right now. We can't. It's not possible. That you are totally loved in this moment, and so am I. You know, and that we can share that and be within ear's range of that, you see. That's what saved me. And you know what? We talk about redemption, having a Savior. I didn't just need a Savior. I need to be saved from me. You know? And that's what saves me, when people announce God to me and they keep announcing it to me, you know, in kindness and love. Ma told me this one time. Tommy, I've been a priest like for 2 weeks. And she said, you know what, now when you're going to be a priest and you're going to screw up stuff and everything. She's telling me this. I said, Ma, thanks for the confidence, you know. She said, well, you are. You're going to screw up stuff. She said, you know what? She said, people will forgive you. The people will forgive you. They understand human weakness. They do. They understand it better than you. The people will forgive you. I said, okay, Ma. She said, you know when they'll have a hard time forgiving you? I'll tell you, Tommy. When you are unkind. When you are unkind. God, is that true? Isn't it so true? When you are unkind. Do everything, she said, not to be unkind, you know. It's so true. All right. So, you know, you don't know this about me, but I'm kind of an intense person. So I can't sleep one night, so I read this. Remember the day I borrowed your brand new car and I dented it? I thought you'd kill me, but you didn't. Remember the time I dragged you to the beach and you said it would rain and it did? I thought you'd say I told you so, but you didn't. Remember the time I flirted with all the guys to make you jealous and you were? I thought you'd leave me, but you didn't. Remember the time I spilled strawberry pie all over your car rug? Oh my God, I thought you'd drop me, but you didn't. Remember the time I forgot to tell you the dance was formal and you showed up in jeans? I thought you'd hit me, but you didn't. Yes, there were lots of things you didn't do, but you put up with me, you loved me, and you protected me. And there were so many things I wanted to make up to you when you returned from Vietnam, but you didn't. So much I wanted to make up to you when you returned from Vietnam, but you didn't. So you know what? I read that at 3 a.m. I can't sleep. I don't sleep that well anyways, but I get enough. I read it at 3 a.m. I pick up my cell phone. I call up Timothy, my twin. He finally answers the dang thing. I said, Tim, I love you. I love you with all my heart. He said, Tommy, you've been drinking? And I called up Sue and Dick and Mike and Pat and Judy and Jim. I got them all out of bed at 3 a.m. And I said, I love you. I love you. Now, here you go. So I'm at his house, my twin, and we're in the kitchen there. And now he's got that table. The same one. He's got it. Except I'm one of them uncles. What the heck happened? And his granddaughter, Rosie, sitting there, says to him, Grandpa, my twin, tell that story about the time that Uncle Tom called you in the middle of the night. Tell that story. And I looked at that little girl's face, my niece, and I thought, she's going to school around this table. She's getting her learning around that table. I can't live your lives. I can't live any of your success or failure, but I can give you kerygma, baby, you know, that you are loved totally and completely in this moment, never to change, okay? And so, I go home to tell my first mass, and I got to tell Ma and Pa that I love them. I'd never told them before. I don't know why that is, but I'm going to tell them that I love them. All right, so I get home, we have the first mass and everything. I'm gonna tell him that I love him. I'm standing there on the porch with him. Timmy's there, he's gonna take me to the airport. I gotta work with the deaf in New Orleans for 6 months. And I said, go on, I've been a priest 2 weeks. I said, go to the car. I said, I wanna talk to Ma and Pa. He says, are you quitting already? Just go to the car. Go, 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 go. So they're standing there, the two of them, and I said, I said, Ma, Pa, I got to say something to you, I got to, and Ma said, okay, what is it, Tommy, what is it? I said, Ma, I want to tell you and Pa something, I do. She said, you already said that. I said, I know, so I'm looking at him, you know, God, I'm looking right at him. I said, And my Ma, you know, she did cry a lot. I don't want to get that going. She's going, you know, she cried at the opening of supermarkets, you know. So I finally look at him. I said, Ma, Pa, I love you too. More than anyone in the world, I do. I don't know how to thank you. I don't. For all that you have been to me. I love you with all my heart, I do. My Ma didn't cry. She looked right at me and she said, I know you love me. And if your Ma was anything like mine, she spoke for Dad. He's standing right there. And she goes, your Dad knows too. She said, we know you love us by the way you are when you're with us, the way you take care of us, the things all of you kids do for us. She said, Tommy, your love is obvious. It is. And then I walked off the porch, going down to the car. I turn around. She always had more to say. She's right on the edge of the step there. Pa's behind her, wrapped like this with his chin on her top of her head, holding her like that. And I turn around. The tears are streaming down her face. And she says, but Tommy, I'll tell you something. There ain't nothing like hearing it. There ain't nothing like hearing it. And so that you are totally and completely loved in this moment, right now, never to change. Okay? Amen, amen, amen. Thank you so much.
Brothers and sisters, we've listened to God's word tonight. We want to respond to that word, the word that's been preached to us, to the following petitions. And so to each of these petitions, just respond, Lord, hear our prayer. Excuse me. We pray that all of us will come to believe that we are sacred and made in the image and likeness of God. We pray to the Lord. We pray that God's unconditional love for us will inspire each one of us to a life of faith, love, and hope. We pray to the Lord. We pray that we will always be faithful to the written word of God and allow it to unite within us a passion for life. We pray to the Lord. We pray that God's transforming love might release in us forgiveness, that we might learn to love each other in the best of times and the worst of times. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that the gift of laughter and tears, which are signs of the Lord's love for us, might bring us all closer to each other. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those who do not know God's love and for anyone here tonight who might be hurting. May they experience the comfort of the Lord's love for them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for the gift of your love in our lives. Thank you for loving us without condition. Help us always to be open to your love and see that love in the lives of those around us. We thank you for this night and for our community here at St. Vincent de Paul. And we ask all this through Christ, who is our Lord forever and ever.
Amen. At this time, Deacon Dan is going to bless us with the word of God.
Oh, okay. I can do that. May Almighty God bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with kindness. And give you peace. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And before Deacon Dana dismisses us now with our closing prayer, just a couple of announcements. They're having a social over there. So they got cheese and wine, I don't know if wine, but cheese, crackers, and food. But they do. They do have cheese and crackers and stuff in the social hall, family life. They want you to come over, all right? And then that gives me a chance to see you as well. And then tomorrow morning, we have Mass at 8 o'clock. I'll say the Mass, and I give just a little short homily at the 8 o'clock Mass. And then we'll get back together again for a different presentation tomorrow at 3 o'clock, so we can be together again tomorrow at 3. Okay, but please come to the social if you can, and might that way it probably makes the parking lot easier to get in and out of. But please come over to the social if you can, okay? And then we'll see you tomorrow at morning at 8 o'clock, and then tomorrow at 3 o'clock.
Okay, dear friends, take what you have learned tonight into your homes, reflect on tonight's message, and share it with your family and friends. Tomorrow, as you begin your day, ask the Lord to bless you, your spouse, and all of your loved ones. Now go into the peace and love of the Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit forever and ever.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 814, With One Voice, 814.
Thank you.
and glory.